witnessing and the Trinity. I have been speaking on the process of witnessing and the dream. The process of dreaming continues until in the dream you are aware of its falsity. Every morning you found the dream to be false. Yet still after 10 or 12 hours you forget this and the process continues. What is the reason that dream appears to be true? Even after dreaming so many times you consider it to be true. This is habitual. That which you see, you consider to be true. This is habit. There is a process in Tantra. It says dream state continues until you become aware of its false in the dream. And until then you will not consider the world of duality as false, and that duality will continue. Right now as you are, you only consider this world of duality to be true. Duality means pair of opposites. You consider pain and pleasure, happiness and sorrow to be true. Tantra has developed certain subtle techniques. You can undertake an experiment. Whenever dream is happening, if you raise your hand or something else like this, then this process stops. Each night before going to sleep, remember this. Then one day you will find this echo deep within even the dream. Some people experiment. If they have to get up early, they just whisper something near the pillow and go to sleep, and it happens that way. Each night before going to sleep, remember this, then one day you will find this echo deep within, even in the dream. One day this echo will enter your subconscious. After a period of 3 to 4 months, one day you will find, as soon as you start dreaming, a remembrance surfaces and you can realize that you are dreaming. The moment you are lost in the scene, the seer disappears. This is the Trinity. The scene, the seer and seen. The moment you are lost in the scene, that is the dream sequence, the seer disappears. The process of awakening has to begin from dreams. Then one day you realize that this world of duality is a dream as well. This is why Hindus call it as Maya or illusion. Gurdjieff used to say, the day your consciousness becomes double-arrowed, that very day you will attain. His effort was, whatsoever you are seeing, someone, never forget this seer. Be aware of both the seen and the seer simultaneously, that someone is seeing and something is being seen. With this, transcendence happens and witnessing is born in you. As soon as witnessing happens, you have attained the Trinity. What is this Trinity? In the Trinity, two are visible, but third remains invisible, the seer, the seen, and the seen. As this Trinity intensifies, the two disappear in oneness. And at this confluence, all three disappear into This is the reason that Hindus call confluence or Sangam as one of the greatest the pilgrimage centers in India. This is a unique confluence. It is a confluence of three rivers. Two streams of Ganges, the clear water, and Yamuna, the blue water, remain visible, and the third, which is Saraswati River, remains invisible. This is not only significant, instead it is symbolic as well. The stream of Saraswati refers to the missing mystical link of consciousness. Meditation or awareness alone can bring that missing link in you. The moment the process of meditation deepens in you, the seer and the seen disappears. So too, when your meditation goes to something, or dhyan, attention goes to something, the object and the subject remain visible because your attention has gone to something that you are doing or remembering. However, that which happens between the two becomes invisible, and that which happens between the two represents the consciousness. And when the three merge into one another, there is oneness, and that oneness is the ultimate in the process of transcendence. Illusion or Maya is like the mother. Out of this, three are born. This is the Hindu concept of incarnation. Incarnation is that which comes into existence out of its own free will as manifestation. That which is worldly, Nanak says, is Brahma, and that which is the custodian of the storehouse is known as Vishnu. And the word that Nanak uses is Bhandari for Vishnu. Bhandar means the storehouse, and Divan is the word that is used for Shiva, the destroyer. When you look at the sequence of the temples, you will not find any temple of Brahma in India, because the creation is done. And why do you have to remember it? There is only one temple of Brahma in India. People did not build the temples because Brahma is worldly. He creates the finite world. He is creating all that is existing into the world. That is the finite world. Whatsoever he creates vanishes. So then why to worship that which is worldly? And the largest number of temples is that of Shiva. It is easiest. You can just put a stone and a temple of Shiva is born. With Shiva, the world of duality comes to an end. He is considered to be the god of death. He is worth worshipping. Brahma creates the world of duality and multiplicity. One of the greatest desires of India is to end the world of duality. Only when this duality ends, another process begins. Shiva is the door to salvation or Nirvana. Nirvana means, it comes from two words, Nir and Van. Van comes from Vani. Vani means sound. A state where sound disappears. And when sound disappears, what remains there? A silence. A state of meditativeness. This is the subtle reason that there are so many temples of Shiva. But your understanding of this is quite different. Generally, we worship out of fear. And quite a few temples of Vishnu are there. There are those who are afraid of death. Such people worship Vishnu. The business community wants to hold on to the world, so they worship Vishnu. Nanak says he is the storekeeper. He is in the middle. He is the custodian of the wealth. So those who have abundant, those who have any attachment to wealth, worship his consort Lakshmi. These sutras that comprise the Japji Sahib or the message of Nanak contained in 37 sutras are like steps. Each step leads to another, and each step is important part of the ladder that takes you to the highest. When you are available, you are alive, there is a ladder of the spiritual masters, the golden chain of the Sufi masters. The sheikh or the master who is at the last step of the ladder will help you to attain to that sky which is open, to reach to the top. That which comes after you will require another one. Just as the process of education is step by step, after completing form 1, you enter into form 2 and the process goes on. So Nanak is using the same methodology. Try to understand this. If you want to get something done by the husband, how do you approach him? You approach him via his wife. There is no other way. If the wife is pleased, the husband is in your hand. Such is the human understanding. Vishnu is the preserver in the middle. And those who are desirous of the world, they worship Vishnu. Shiva is the end. He is the embodiment of renunciation from the world of duality. For Shiva, you need not any flowers. Just a few leaves are enough for the worship if you are going into the ritualistic aspect of this. This Trinity is the sutra of birth, life and death. Remember, birth is not in your hand. Okay, this is already there, so there is no need to worship Brahma that creates. Life is available. Life is continuing. And when life is continuing, this has to be preserved or sustained. This is the reason there are people who worship Vishnu. These are not very wise. Life is slipping out of your hand each finite moment. And you are not aware of it. With each day, day is too long. With each moment, life slips out of your hand. Until this awareness comes, your journey of transcendence cannot begin. Man remains unaware. He is involved with his merrymaking and worldly enjoyment. And every moment as he is engrossed into his pleasure-seeking activities, life is slipping out of his hands and he is totally unaware of it. Life is slipping from your hands each finite moment as it comes. And remember, everything that is precious in life happens in a moment. Love happens in a moment. Death happens in a moment. Love is not a prolonged process. Just in a spontaneous moment it happens. It is slipping out of your hand and you are unaware. Until this awareness comes, your journey of transcendence cannot begin. And then when one moment dissolves, another is born. And unless the awareness of death becomes intense, you will remain worldly. What is the difference between the worldly and the non-worldly? A seeker is the one who has realized the futility of life. He has realized that life will certainly end in death. Soon being will become non-being. Enter into another realm. That which has come into life will certainly vanish. One who has got the awareness of death, his life undergoes transformation. To become aware of the moment slipping out of your hand is the process. Except man, no other creature has religion. No other creature has the awareness of death. Animals cannot hear the footsteps of approaching death. To witness death, a particular awareness is needed. And among man, you are like the animals that has no awareness of death. You will remain animal-like until you begin to hear the footsteps of death approaching. Death has knocked at your door the moment life has entered. The day Brahma started his work, the role of Shiva began. But you are not aware. You remain engrossed in the middle of the world. The day Brahma started his work, the role of Shiva began, because the moment the process of creation begins, the role of destruction comes into existence. One who has forgotten death has become oblivious of God. You have come into life many times, and many a times you have crossed over to the other shore of death. Still you go on forgetting this. Remember death each finite moment. Let death be the central theme of life. Except death, there is nothing more definite in life. If this certainty of death becomes the central theme, then certainly you can begin inward journey. That very day you have moved away from many to three. And one who has reached to three, one door is now open. Nanak says it is God alone that directs these three according to the law of existence. You are like a goat or a cow that has a long rope around her neck. The rope is her freedom as well as her bondage. The length of the rope gives the animal a certain freedom, but it cannot go beyond the ordained distance. This, who decides this ordained distance? It is the owner who decides how far it can allow the goat or the cow to graze. However, the length of rope can be varied. Such is the relationship between you and God. This is what you can call destiny. It is in your hand. Through your awareness, through your understanding, you can get this rope lengthened. As your understanding of the existential law deepens, you go on falling within its circumference or circle. Your freedom will go on increasing. That's why people who are around
the awakened ones, something of the awakening in an infinitesimal quantum enters into the seeker, and as it enters, the destiny begins to change. This is what we call in astrological terms. His level of understanding begins to change. With that, the nature of bliss and the life also changes. Remember one thing, you can never go beyond. As your understanding of the existential law deepens, you will go on falling within its circle. Your freedom will go on increasing. Remember one thing, you can never go beyond his boundaries. And if this remembrance deepens, you can even come out of sin. Also, this very remembrance, with this very remembrance, you come out of virtue as well. As this remembrance deepens, you become more and more like an instrument. I do all he wants me to do. He has given me this life and an understanding. Then why let ego remain? As this happens, bliss descends. Such is not your understanding as yet. Your understanding is like that of a fly that was riding the wheel of the chariot and thought itself to be bigger, as big as the chariot. Because the chariot was moving, the fly was sitting on the wheel. As the chariot was moving, it was raising the dust. The fly was sitting on the wheel of a chariot. The chariot was moving at a speed. Chariot was big, as many horses were yoked to it. The fly saw all around. Seeing the cloud of dust, the fly thought that it has grown big. And because she is moving, this dust is flying. So too, you are sitting on the wheel of time, which moves swiftly, and the dust that is there in the atmosphere is not because of you as you think. Instead, it is happening because of the cosmic wheel as it is moving. The day you understand this, tremendous peace will descend in your life. All disturbance and chaos in life is because of ego. Ego discovers many unnecessary things. As your understanding clears that in the wheel of time, you are no more than a fly, that very moment peace descends. More often meditators inquire, there is no happiness in their lives. Can a master give peace? Certainly, as long as your ego remains, peace cannot happen. Because you are the ego and you are the problem. The moment you disappear, peace descends on its own. And when I said you disappear, means ego disappear. You do not consider yourself as the fly was thinking, that it is she who is moving at such a pace, and because of that movement dust is flying. As such as you are like a fly, like a lie. You are dream. If I have to correctly say it, you are in fact a dream within the dream. You are not even a dream. Have you ever noticed that there is sometimes you are dreaming, and in the dream you dream that you are dreaming? You lie down on the bed. As soon as you lie down on the bed, you fall asleep and you are dreaming. And this process of dream within the dream can continue. I have heard an ancient Chinese story. The story says a woodcutter was cutting wood by lunch. He was tired, so he went to take a short nap. He dreamt a hidden treasure buried nearby. He went and dig up the place to find the treasure buried underground. There was just little bit dust. The pot was full of gold and diamonds. He thought that during the night he will return to collect the treasure, as it was risky during the day. The man was poor. For identification, he stuck a wood in the ground and he returned home. When it was dark, he went to the place. On reaching, he found the stick was intact, but treasure was missing. Surprised, he returned home and narrated the entire story to his wife. He told his wife that he is unable to decide if he really saw the dream or not. The stick is still stuck in the ground. This is enough proof that he did not dream. And also the pot was there, because the pot are empty now. This is enough proof that someone else has taken away the treasure. The man has dreamt. The wife said, definitely you would have dreamt that you went in the night. You saw the stick stuck there and the treasure was missing. Go to sleep now. That very night, another person dreamt the same treasure. He saw the woodcutter leaving the stick there as mark of identification. When he woke up, he ran to the place and saw the stick. He brought the treasure home. He told his wife that he is not sure if it was a dream or reality. Whatever be the case, I have brought the treasure home. This certainly proves that I was not dreaming. I saw the woodcutter sticking the wood. That is why I brought the treasure. The wife said, the treasure is clear. And this is certain, that you saw the woodcutter sticking the wood. It is not safe to keep the treasure now. It is better to inform the king and let him decide. The man was honest. He carried the treasure for the king, but then the complaint of the woodcutter was also launched. The king got worried. The king said, whatever be the reason, one thing is certain, that both of you dreamt. And he divided the treasure among the two. That night the king told the incident to his wife. His wife said, definitely you would have dreamt, now go to sleep. This is an important story in China. For thousands of years, people contemplate who actually dreamt. Something like this happens in life. Whatsoever happened was dreamlike, and it becomes difficult to decide if the wood was really stuck. At the time of death, everything appears on the screen like a dream as well. Those who have known say that everything is dream of the open eye. This is dream because there is no connection between the dream and that which is. This is the state of feeling in between. This does not matter if you have seen with open eyes or with closed eyes. The dream symbolizes that it is now and it will not remain later. So is the nature of the life as well. One moment it is there and next moment it is not. Next moment life has slipped out of your hand. In this dream, there is another dream. That dream is your ego. You consider yourself as the doer in all these dreams. The whole world sees your dream. Only you cannot see this. Unless witness arises in you, you will really remain blind. Blind to consciousness. Also, there is dream within the dream. This strengthens the feeling of the doer. The world of finiteness creates this feeling of the doer in an individual. You remain a dream within a dream. The day you will hear the footsteps of death, I dissolves. You can now save yourself from death. If the outgoing breath does not come in, what can you do? Then you realize that you are helpless in front of death. Therefore, try to forget the reality of life, then ego cannot hurt. Wise remembers death. Death brings ego to its natural death. The day you understand the nature of death, death means one moment comes, next moment it slips out of your hand. A raindrop falls on the leaf and with a plop it dissolves into the lake. A wave comes and next moment it dissolves. Such is the nature. The day you understand the death totally is nature, it is the finite that disappears. You will not be able to save ego. If you aspire to attain to oneness, then always remember the footsteps of death. There is no greater truth than death, and a master teaches you how to live moment to moment. This moment is ultimate, and the moment this moment disappears and you become aware of this, in fact you have become aware of death. The outcome of this truth is the dissolution of ego. When you begin to see death clearly, ego decomposes. This awareness of death is really the antidote for ego. The moment ego vanishes, you realize that he is the ultimate doer and you are simply an instrument. God goes on seeing and caring for you. However, because of your ego, you cannot see all that is happening. It is strange. Try to understand this. Nanak says he can see the Trinity of the creator, the preserver, and the destroyer. However, none of these can see him. This is significant for each aspirant. You see this finite world with your eyes, and the seer that is hidden within your eyes as well. But your eyes cannot see that which is hidden, that which makes you see. You touch the entire world with your hands, but your hand cannot see the seer within you. Because when hand touches something, it is an act of perception. The information reaches within, and it reaches to the space that this hand does not know. That is why it is said that you see everything with your eyes, you touch the entire world with your hands, but your hands cannot see the seer within you. That where all the information is placed, this is what Nanak calls, he uses two words, panch parwan, panch pardhan. Means there are five organs of perception and five organs of actions. And who is the master of these organs of perception and action is Dhyan. Panch Parvan, five organs of action and five organs of perception. Pancha ka guru, eight Dhyan. And meditation is solitary one, and that is the master of the two. All information through the organs of perception comes. But where does this information is processed? Your hands cannot see. The purpose of the hand, there are, look at an organization that is conducting a survey. There are persons who are on the field. Their job is to collect the statistics. A certain format is created. He does not know who created the format. All he know that this particular ministry, this particular organization has created the format for the survey. All he is going to do, go to the individuals and collect the information to fit in that format and then submit it. He submits it to his superior and the process goes on until it goes to the person that this surveyor does not know. His job was to collect the information and carry it. The organs of perception is like that. They collect the information for you and send it to the boss, the higher authority, which is the master of everything, the meditation. The information is processed there. Now, result or the outcome of the survey is obtained. Based on that, a particular law, particular change in the existing law is made, and through the organs of action, it enters into the outer world of finiteness. Nanak says, Brahma the creator, Vishnu the preserver, and Mahesh or Shiva the destroyer are three eyes or three faces of the ultimate reality. These eyes see the world, but these cannot see that which is behind these. That which is hidden within you remains beyond your reach. You can see only that which your eyes, you can see only that. You can see that only when your eyes are closed for the outer, because this is inner. Your eyes open in the outer world and you can see only which is visible, which your eyes are accustomed to. The moment your eyes close to the outer, you begin to see that which is within. To move within, all avenues of your consciousness have to move and its direction has to change. Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh are the ways for your consciousness to move outwards. There are many beautiful and meaningful stories. It is said when Buddha attained enlightenment, Brahma came to bow down to Buddha. Bowing down his head at the feet of Buddha, Brahma expressed the desire for knowledge. Nanak is pointing towards this. A man of wisdom is higher than even your Trinity. The Trinity that we, every religion has a Trinity. Every organized religion has a Trinity. And Nanak says, a man of awareness, man of understanding is even beyond this Trinity. Even Brahma comes to the company of such a person. Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh represents the three faces. And as long as you are three, you cannot know one. One can only be known by going beyond the three. Hindus have created beautiful stories. No one else could create such stories. It is said in the beginning of the creation, Brahma created the earth first. Earth is the daughter of Brahma because it came out of him. After earth was created, Brahma fell in love and started chasing the earth. This is what the situation of each one of us. We create something, and that which we create, we love that. You create a painting, you love it, you see it over and over again and again, as if you have fallen in love with that. To save herself from the lust of her father Brahma, she assumed many forms. Each time the earth assumed a new female form, the story says Brahma assumed the counterfeit male form. The West could not understand the relevance of such stories. But these stories are very significant as far as human understanding is concerned. Hindus say even God is worldly. Aurobindo says as far as awareness is concerned, man is higher than gods. I am talking about semi-gods, demigods. These gods are faces of Brahma. That is why Buddha is higher than all these. Brahma can fell in lust for his creation. Daughter means that which comes out of him. Man falls in love with all that is his creation. Your creation is your dream, and this becomes your lust or passion, and you start running behind your own creation. That which is the outcome of your passion interests you the most. This is what Hindu story is trying to explain. Your gods are bound by finiteness as in the man. This is the reason that even Brahma has to bow at the feet of Buddha. Nanak says, this is wonder of wonders. God can see the Trinity, but the Trinity cannot see him. This is strange, and not strange as well. Why the three cannot see? This is not strange, because how can three see one? The moment three returns, three are no more, only one is. Let me explain this further. Masters have constantly said that you can never meet God. Why you cannot meet God, and everybody is in search of God? The day you will meet God, you will be no more. Kabir says, Jab main tha tab harina. When I was, as long as I existed, God was not there. And the moment God appeared, I am no more. The day you will meet God, you will be no more. Before meeting, you will cease to exist. Before the drop knows the ocean, or comes to know, it exists. The moment it dissolves, it becomes oceanic. And that very process of drop becoming ocean is, you can say that drop has known ocean. You can say it language wise, but the drop does not exist to say that I have known the ocean now. Only up to the point that the drop has not merged in the ocean, this feeling remains that I am going to know the ocean. The moment drop dissolves, that thought disappears, because the drop has become the ocean itself. It is no more a drop that wanted to know what ocean is like. The drop is the ego. Ego cannot meet God. The moment the drop of ego vanishes, your identity is lost. The drop has merged in the ocean. The moment drop is merged in the ocean, it is no more a drop. in its form as drop, it cannot, in its form as drop, it cannot meet the ocean. The moment drop comes to meet the ocean, it loses its identity, because now it is reaching the final. Then it is no more a drop, instead it is oceanic. There is no one to say that I am drop. The drop is no more. In the final analysis, the micro is no more, only the ultimate is. And this concept of Trinity exists in various names and forms in almost all the experiences of the custodians of the religion. Be it Hindu seers or Christian or Holy Prophet. The same thing happens with Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh. The moment journey is reversed, journey begins homeward, three can be no more. In the beginning there was oneness, and in the end of the journey there will again be oneness. If you have to pay the regards, then pay to that alone who is. Nanak says you are paying the regard to Trinity. Someone worships Vishnu, the other worships Brahma, someone worships Shiva. None of these three can see God. So if you want to remember or pay regards, do this to that oneness alone. He alone is the beginning, the end and the middle. That alone is the end, and that remains formless beyond time and space. This requires courage. You cannot get courage to pay regards to Him. All your respects are meaningful, and without any gain you can never bow. Both you and your gods are inflicted by the desire. You seek and they fulfill your desires. This is the entire concept of the priestly community. It establishes a connection between you and the God. All your prayers remain for worldly gains, because both are worldly. Your prayer for Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesh are all for worldly gains. You can seek one only when you are ready to leave the finite world and its affairs, and you are not interested in gaining anything which is finite. Remember, only after attaining to oneness something can really happen. Many go on striving but attain nothing. Yet still your eyes never open. The moment to reach the One, everything becomes possible. There are temples of this Trinity, but there is no temple of God. Nanak gave a beautiful name to his temple and he called it Gurudwara. This is not temple of God. Instead, it is a door to the Master. Guru means Master. The word Dwara can be interpreted in two different ways. The Sanskrit language is such that it has the same word with a slight difference of intonation, or the voice modulation can give a different kind of meaning and effect. Dwara means through also. Master is the door through which you can come in the open space. And Dwara means door also. Master is the door. Both ultimately give the same meaning. This is the door alone. From the door you can come in or access, but you do not stay in the door. You do not stay in the door. Door is the passage through which you can come in or can go out. Door cannot be your resting place. Door refers to transcendence. Master is the transcendence. is not your resting place. You simply pass through Gurdwara, the door of the Master. Beyond this door of the Master lies the abode or the realm of that which is truth. And Nanak calls this as Ra, the ultimate. If this feeling has arisen, pay regards. Heart is ready to pay regards, then do this. Entire creation is his abode or the resting place. Also, this creation is his storehouse. It is filled once, never to finish. His stock is perennial and can never come to an end. He is the creator that goes on admiring his creation. Out of truth, only truth evolves. All salutations need to be directed to him alone. He is the beginning. He alone remains in the end. He is unheard, uncreated, beyond finiteness, formless. And this formlessness is his God.